Welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church in Sacramento, California. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message, and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John continues a series entitled, The Epistle to the Hebrews. Joseph lived an extraordinary life that had its share of ups and downs. He came from a dysfunctional family that consisted of one father, four mothers, and hateful siblings that could not speak peaceably with him and eventually sold him into slavery. Despite this, Joseph never allowed himself to become depressed and defeated because of circumstances, but looked continually to God as his source. His godly attitude in life changed the circumstances that surrounded him. God is still busy today saving and grooming men and women. And just like with Joseph, the earth is his training field for the new creation. This message is entitled, Joseph's Struggle. Now, let's go to the sanctuary and join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise God and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church on February 3rd, 2013. And I'm glad you are here. And I'm glad for the message that God has given me that we're going to share with you here today. And I believe it's going to be a powerful message that could help each one of us. So why don't we stand one more time and pray over the message. Heavenly Father, I want to thank and praise you right now that we can gather here today in the name of Jesus. And that, Father God, your word is powerful, more powerful than a two-edged sword and cutting to asunder soul and spirit. We thank you right now, Lord, that the word will go out with such power that it would change our lives and send us, Father God, into a fire that, Lord, cannot be quenched. And this we ask in Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated. I had several titles on this message I thought about. You know, one title could be The Devil's Soup Kitchen. You ever seen his soup kitchen out there on the streets? And the soup he serves up is pretty hot, but it's pretty lousy. And we got it to Joseph's struggle. In Hebrews 11, verse number 22, we read this. By faith, Joseph, when he died, made mention of the departing of the children of Israel and gave commandment concerning his bones. Joseph simply told the children of Israel that you're going to leave Egypt someday. When you do, take my bones with you. And they did. Moses did take the bones with him. So, who was Joseph? Well, we know the story. I'm not going to dwell so much on the story as what we can learn out of this, because it's a story of you and me. Now, Abraham had a son by the name of Isaac. Isaac had a son by the name of Jacob. And Jacob had a very, very dysfunctional family. It is impossible, if you think about it, to marry two sisters and then get a hold of two concubines or people, women, not people, but women, more or less like prostitutes. And so you have two sisters, two concubines, and you manage to get 13 children out of them and to have peace and harmony. Jacob's household was nothing but peace and harmony. There was always strife. The two sisters didn't like each other. They were striving. The concubines, they were upset because they were concubines. They were not fully heirs. And the children, of course, they fought among each other. There were never any peace there. So let's go to Genesis chapter 37. That's Genesis chapter 37. And we pick it up here in verses 1 through 4. And Jacob dwelt in a land where his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren. And the lad was with the son of Bilhan, and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. In other words, Jacob used Joseph to spy on his brothers. And he brought an evil report. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. That was, he had authority. It was like a king's robe. And when his brethren saw that his father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. That was his childhood. You would think that if God wants to use a man for something great, or a woman, that he would go and select a person that comes from a very nice background, good education, all together. But very seldom do you find that men and women that have risen and become leaders of this earth came from such a background. You see, it doesn't matter the background you have. What matters is who is inside of you, and that's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. So no one can really say this, you know, well, you know, my background is so lousy, you know, that I really don't have a chance. Would you have not understood as simple as this? God doesn't need you per se. He needs your body. He wants your soul and spirit. He wants your mind. He wants to use you. He wants to shape you. But the one that does the work is God the Father inside of you through the Holy Spirit. And he can take any person. It doesn't matter who they are. Jesus raised people from the dead. And God can certainly raise you and me up what he wants. Now I want you now to understand, we're going to give you a panorama right here. I want to take you back now to Adam and Eve. So we have Adam and Eve now being created on this earth. God has a plan for them. Satan put up his soup kitchen in the garden. And he simply served up, he simply told Eve, you know, would you like my soup? If you follow me and do this and that, you know, you'll be just like God, knowing good and evil. And she thought about it, and she thought, well, you know, maybe don't. I'd like to get up and march. So she ate of his soup, and of course, you know the story, they fell in sin and got kicked out. God knew that beforehand. She had a plan to redeem mankind. Let me put this in your mind there. The Bible says in 1 Peter, if it is in 1 Peter, 2 Peter, I cannot tell, but it's in one of the Peters, that 1,000 years for us is a day for the Lord, and a day like 1,000 years. Do you realize, since Adam, it is beyond now 7 days down the road? Long time for us. For God, it's just a week. We are actually in the 8th day right now. Roughly, it's about 2:15 in the morning on the 8th day after God created Adam and Eve. So God decided this, now I'm going to do something here for people on earth. So he decided to call out Abraham. He wanted to create a nation. Now, God is patient. You know, he works every day, you know, a day is long to him, you know, short to us. So he simply decided this, that he would take Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph. Oh, that's only 200 years. Just a couple, maybe an hour, 2 hours or so. A few hours. He said he was not going to put them down in Egypt. And when he went to Egypt, there were 70 persons, Jacob and 70 persons came to Egypt to be fed by Joseph, prime minister. And in Egypt, he simply kept them for 430 years. Nothing happened around the rest of the world. And God was simply growing a nation of 70 people became 3 million men, women, and children. He extracted them out of Egypt, took 40 years, an hour, they spent an hour in the desert, came into the land of Canaan, and then God waited another 1,000 years plus before he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to live and die on a cross, to be resurrected, and to pay for our sins. God works in long term. He is not rushed like we are. Now, if you realize this, that during the last 7 days on this earth, or 7,000 years, only a fraction of people have been saved. I would say that 98%, 99% of all people born on this earth and died up to this point have gone to hell and are lost. God is also in another business. He also wants people to be citizens of his kingdom, his eternal kingdom. So God has two purposes. He has a plan for you here, and he got a better plan for you in eternity. Most of us cannot understand eternity, so we concentrate on life here. And if life is not good here, if life sucks here, we simply say, oh man, you know, it's wasted. No, it's not wasted. God is working on you for eternity. And what we need to do is to understand that everything might not be preachy here, but in eternity, we talk at a different ballgame. Now, I want to talk about Joseph's visions here. You find it from verse 5 to 11. And Joseph dreamed a dream, and he told it to his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. And he said unto them, hear, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose. Also stood upright, and behold, your sheaf stood round about, and made obeisance to my sheaf. And his brethren said to him, shall you indeed reign over us? Or shall you indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. And he dreamed yet another dream, and he told his brethren, and said, behold, I have dreamed a dream more, and behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. And he told his father and his brethren, his father rebuked him and said unto him, what is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall I and my mother and your brethren need come to bow down ourselves to you, to earth? And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the saying. Each one of us have a dream. I don't care what people say about you. But God has laid something down in us that gives us hope, that drives us, that a better day is coming. It's in us. And Joseph, now God knew that Joseph was going to have a horrible time for 13 long years. 17 when he was sold as a slave, 30 years when he became a prime minister, 13 years. So God gave him two visions. We do not know how much more because the Bible doesn't give us the details here. But most likely, the Holy Spirit must be spoken to Joseph. So Joseph always knew that eventually, someday, these dreams will be fulfilled. If you got a dream, you can take a lot of abuse. I want to share something with you here that has been puzzling to me over the years, and it's very strange. When I was about 4 to 5 years old, we lived next to the Pentecostal church in our hometown. And I played with the pastor's children, and many times I was up there in his study and talking to him, and he didn't blow me away. And I remember going up to his study one day, and he had a picture there, and it was a picture of the Great Supper, what they called, where we all to come together, and we are invited to the marriage lamb of the marriage feast of the lamb. Okay? I'm thinking Swedish now. So I stood there and I looked upon, I was just an enormous amount of people. You could just see them go back there. And I asked this pastor, I said, "Now, what does that picture mean?" He didn't just pat me on the head and said, "Oh, son, you know, you're too young, you know, don't worry about that." He explained it to me. I understood it. And I remember I said, "Pastor, I'm going to be there." 4 or 5 years old. That has carried me over the years. This pastor was a baptized in the Holy Spirit, Pentecostal, he gave prophecies. And God gave him a vision over me. As a little boy, 5 years old, and before he left town, went to another city, he had a vision. He never told me the vision. He never told my parents the vision. But he told it to two of his children. One girl and one boy. And so I wandered away, got into sin, all kind of things, just meandered around and so on for the next 25 years, and then came to Christ, gave my life back to him. And in 1971, I came back to my hometown, and I met this man, and his name was Sam. And Sam looked at me and he said, "You know," he said, "it's incredible." He said, "My father had a vision about you. But I don't know if I dare to tell you the vision because you might destroy it." You know how it is. If you know that you're going to eventually end up, let's say, you know, in some place, and you know there's 15 years before you can get there, you know what you do. If you have prophecy, you're good to go there. You just say, "Hey, I skip the other jumps here. You know, I just go straight there." But you got to go through the steps to get to your there. So he never told me. That was before the internet. Because 1971, you know, someone said, "You got internet connection?" We're going to say, what is that, you know? We did not know. We didn't have computers on that, really. And so I begged him. He said, "Well, I might tell you next time you show up." So I showed up another time, another year. And he said, "No, I can't tell you." He said, I don't dare. It is too beyond what I can even think." Well, the sad thing is, God took him home, and he had a sister living in another town, and God took her home. And I will find out the vision when I get there. All I know is that God has something very special for me before I finish on this earth. That's all I know. This has been carrying me for years. And this will carry Joseph. And I want you to nourish the visions, the dreams that God has given you. In verse number 12 in the same chapter there, we have the murder plot. And that's in, let me get to the right chapter here. I'm going to be in chapter 37 and verse number 12. And his brethren went to feed their father's flock in Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "Do not your brethren feed the flock in Shechem? Come, and I will send you unto them." And I said to him, "Here I am." And he said to him, "Go on, pray, see whether it be well with your brethren, and well with the flocks, and bring me word again." So he sent them out to the vale of the Hebron, and they came to Shechem. And a certain man found him, and behold, he was wandering in the field. And the man asked him, saying, "What do you seek?" And he said, "I seek my brethren, tell me, I pray, where they feed their flocks." And the man said, "They are departed then, for I heard them say, let's go to Dothan." And Joseph went to his brethren, and he found them in Dothan. And when they saw him afar off, even before he came near unto them, they conspired against him to slay him. And they said to one another, "Behold, this dreamer comes. Come now, therefore, let us slay him, and cast him in some pit, and we will say some evil beast that devoured him, and we shall see what will come of his dreams." Notice now, why did they hate him? Because his dad showed him favor. He had a coat of authority, but most of all, he had a vision from God. They could not care less about God. And the reason people hate you and are not saved is because they don't have a vision, they are not walking with God, and I hate you because you are walking with the Lord. They envy that, they hate you. And they simply said, "We will slay him." But now you understand that people can only do as much as God wants. God intervened. And Reuben heard it. He delivered them out of their hands and said that they not killed him. Who was Reuben? Reuben was the son of Leah, the firstborn to Jacob. And Reuben really was in competition with Joseph. But it was something in Reuben where he simply said, "No, we are not going to kill him. Shed no blood, but we cast him into this pit, that is in the wilderness, and lay no hold upon him that he might rid him out of their hands to deliver him to his father again." And it came to pass when Joseph was come to his brethren, that they stripped Joseph of his coat of many colors on him. They took him and cast him into a pit, and the pit was empty. There was no water in it. We do not know how long Joseph was in that pit. For a few hours, overnight, we do not know that. But there was no water in there. Mention that. There's a desert. Very important to have water. His brothers now simply said, "Well, you know, let's just have a nice meal." Reuben was gone someplace. And we read this here in verse 25. They sat down to eat bread. They lifted up their eyes and looked, and behold, the company of Ishmaelites came from Gilead, with the camels bearing spicery and balm and myrrh going to carry down to Egypt. And Judah said to his brethren, What profit is it if you slay a bird and conceal his blood? In other words, we're not going to make any money on this. Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him, for he is our bread and our flesh. And his brethren were content. Then there passed by Midianites, merchantmen. They threw and lifted up Joseph out of the pit and sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. And they brought Joseph into Egypt. Let's think about the emotions now of Joseph. First of all, he was manhandled by his brethren, thrown in the pit, sitting down there. At night in the desert, he got cold, hot in the daytime. Suddenly he was holed up. His coat was gone, just had his undergarment on. And he couldn't believe his ears. But his brother said, "You want to buy this, boy? $20 is yours." The Midianites said, "Yeah, sure." They went over there, shackled him up, counted out the cash, gave it to his brothers, and off they went. It probably took weeks to get down there to Egypt. Can you imagine Joseph now, shackled, walking with the camels, other prisoners? And he realized, "I will never see home again. I'm done. My dreams are gone." Do you understand the agony he was under? Now, God allowed that. God knew, "Joseph, I'm just going to bring you down to Egypt. We're going to spend 13 years down there, but you're going to come out all right." Notice, to build character, you will never know the ending of your life. To build character, you have to walk in faith. Step by step by step. Increment by increments. And someday you look back and say, "Wow. Now I understand." If you can get that concept into you when you're in your 20s, you will save a lot of tears and heartache. If you notice that God will never leave you, he will never forsake you, he will never destroy you, but he's building your character. Joseph now was a son to a cattle baron. He knew how to milk cows and how to take care of camels and donkeys and sheep and so on, goats. He had no education except, you know, just being in the cattle business. And God simply said, "Well, I got to educate this boy." And to educate him, I have to move him from the land of Canaan into Egypt, and I'm going to have two men teach him, Potiphar and a jailer. Those were his professors. Now, he became a slave. He was on his way to Egypt. And then we read this here in verse number 36. "And the Midianites sold him into Egypt unto Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh and a captain of the guard." Here you have now Joseph. You've seen the way we used to sell black people here in this country. They would simply have a podium. They strip a guy down just to have, you know, just a underwear. They would come up, you know, and says, "Flex your muscles, open your mouth, check the teeth, you know, just like you buy a horse." And here Joseph stood, you know, probably a good handsome man. Had people look him over. Potiphar came over and says, he looks pretty good. You know, well, you buy a dog, you know, it looks pretty good. I'll buy him. And he took it home. Now, when he came to Potiphar's house, first of all, most likely he did not speak the language the Egyptians spoke. He didn't speak that. The Egyptian civilization was higher. And he was brought in like a boy from the countryside that didn't know anything. What you want to learn now from this is simple as he refused defeat. Circumstances are stepping stones. Circumstances are stepping stones. Most people are killed by circumstances. Joseph and I had to make a decision. Am I going to get depressed? Not eating, and just dying, and starve to death, and just die? Or am I going to learn the language, master this civilization, and float to the top? He learned the language. He floated to the top. First six verses in chapter 39. And Joseph are brought down to Egypt and put it for an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, brought him in the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down thither. And the Lord was with Joseph. He was a prosperous man. He was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him. He could see on Joseph that here he was anointed. And that the Lord made all that he had, all that he did, to prosper in his hand. And Joseph found grace in his sight, and he served him, and he made him oversee over his house, and all that he had he put into his hand. And it came to pass for the time that he had made him oversee in his house, and over all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was upon all that he had in the house and in the field. And he left all that he had in Joseph's hand. He knew not all that he had, save the bread which he did eat. And Joseph was a goodly person and well favored. We do not know how many years he spent in Potiphar's house. But I want you to see something there. Joseph did not look back. His goal was not to work himself up so he could run back to Canaan's land. He simply said, I will apply myself. I will serve God. He must have had a prayer time. And he simply applied himself and proud. He was proud to be able to do the very best. And Potiphar was a rich man. He was the captain of the guard of the king of Egypt, of Pharaoh. He was the top dog in that society. And Joseph, not suddenly, from being a slave boy, he was not a manager of Potiphar's house. I'm sure that Joseph now thought, you know, well, maybe this is a dream, you know, I'm coming up this high. And then came Satan with his portable soup kitchen. Do you understand that Satan has a portable soup kitchen? Just like you see these guys, you know, with hot dogs, a little vendor coming with a, you know, that's what he has. And he moved his cart into the house, served Potiphar's wife with some soup, And she began to lust after that, you know, handsome man, you know, flexing his muscles. And day and night she said, hey, boy, let's have some sex, man. Let's just go for it. Potiphar is gone. Just you and me can make some pretty music. I'm sure she was not ugly. I'm sure she was seducing. And the Bible said day and night, she was after Joseph. Joseph could have simply said, well, hey, what? Boss is gone? He won't know. Why not? That's how most people think today. But you know what? Listen to this. And it came to pass after the thing that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph. And she said, lie with me. But he refused and said to his master's wife, behold, my master wants not what is with me in the house. He's committed all that has to my hand. There's none greater in this house than I, neither has he kept back anything from me but you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? And it came to pass, as she spake to Joseph day by day, that he hearkened unto her to lie by her or be with her. And it came to pass, Joseph went into the house to do his business, and there was none of the men in the house there within. And she called him by his garment, saying, lie with me, and he left his garment in her hand, and he fled and got him out. Nothing more angry than a woman who gets scorned if she is full of lust. And it came to pass when she saw he had left his garment in her hand and were fled forth, that she called to the men of the house, spake to them, saying, see, he has brought in a Hebrew unto us to mock us. He came in unto me to lie with me, and I cried with a loud voice. A lying woman. Satan knows our emotions. Okay. There's nothing more harder to deal with than when you do something that is right. You've done it right, and then you get accused for doing something wrong. And the devil then brings the soup kitchen portable to your table and simply says, I'd like you to have some soup for me. Because you see, right now we have indignation. How dare that woman do that? How dare she lie against me? And that's how the devil attacks all of us. When Potiphar came home, normally an offense like this was death. But I'm sure that Potiphar knew his wife. He's done this with others. And he simply spared Joseph. God simply told him, put him in jail. And he went to jail. Look in verse 20. And Joseph's master took him and put him into prison, a place where the king's prisoners were bound, and he was there in a prison. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy, giving favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. Now, when Joseph was thrown in there, he was shackled, manhandled, and the keeper of the prison, jailer, simply knew that he's been working for the captain of the guard, second in command. And he did not give him too good treatment to begin with. When Joseph came into the prison there, it was bad enough to be sold as a slave. He worked himself up and thought, you know, man, I got out of that. He went from here to the bottom, the pit. Can you imagine how Satan talking to Joseph? Joseph, God does not love you. If God loved you, you wouldn't be here. You're never going to get out of this hellhole. You're going to rot here. So that's what you get, Joseph, for being nice. Being morally, not having sex with you, his wife, not stealing from him? Is that the reward that God's gave you for doing all these great things in the pit, in the prison? Can you hear the soup that Satan was serving up? What made Joseph tick? He had a vision, two visions, two dreams. I'm sure that he must have felt bad to begin with. But then I'm sure he would have simply said this: I'm going to focus myself on God. Put your eyes upon Jesus. And when he focuses his eyes upon God, guess what? He probably didn't get a job right away. Maybe he got a job to just, you know, knocking stone, breaking stones. So he was out there, you know, just breaking stone, but breaking them more than anyone else. And the jailer sort of says, I'm not going to have him breaking stones. You know, I'm going to do something better. Get a little better job, a little better job. And before he knew it, he ran the jail. And the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph all the prisoners were in the prison. Whatsoever they did there, he was a doer of it. The keeper of the prison looked not to anything that was under his hand, because the Lord was with him, and that which he did, the Lord made it to prosper. Now, he was there maybe for 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, we don't know. And then I'm just going to go inside of memory and just share this with you. So one day, Pharaoh, the king, gets upset with his baker and his butler. The butler's a guy that served him food and tasted the food. And the baker was the one that baked the food and other things. And these two officers came in, and they were sitting around. And then God simply said, now, I'm going to move. And he gave these two men dreams. Joseph now had the capacity to interpret dreams. He must have done it in prison to others. He interpreted the dreams. He told the butler, you're going to be restored to your original job. So the baker said, you're going to hang. And sure enough, the baker hung. The butler got back his job. The last thing Joseph said to the butler was, hey, man, when you go to the king, put in a word for me. I'd like to get promoted. He was hoping, nice to run a jail, but I'd like to run something nicer. I'd like to be married. Maybe I'd like to make a vacation to Canaan land. And you know what happened? He sat in that cell, in that prison, for another 2 years. 2 years. And then God moved. The butler, Pharaoh, had a dream. And Pharaoh was upset. Who can interpret this? And the butler, you know what? This guy in your prison over here, I met him 2 years ago. He told me I'll be restored. He told the baker would hang. He can interpret your dream. Pharaoh said, bring him over. And you know the rest of the story. He was put in the position of prime minister. But I want you to see now Genesis chapter 45. Genesis chapter 45. And this is where we're going to learn a very strong principle today. Genesis chapter 45, the first 8 verses. This is after Joseph has made himself known to his brothers that came down to Egypt. After the famine. Then Joseph could not refrain himself before all them that stood by him, and he cried, "Cause every man to go out from here." And there stood no man with him, but Joseph made himself known unto his brethren. And he wept aloud, and the Egyptians of the house of Pharaoh heard. I want you to see something now. Why did Joseph weep? 13 years of pent-up emotions. 13 years as a slave, as a prisoner, not seeing his dad anymore. These emotions were pent up. And he cried. And Joseph said to his brethren, "I am Joseph. Does my father yet live?" And his brethren could not answer him, for they were troubled at his presence. They thought Joseph was gone. This man, the prime minister of Egypt, Joseph, he's going to kill us. I know it. He's going to hang us. And Joseph said to his brethren, "Come near to me, I pray you." And they came near. And he said, "I am Joseph, your brother." Whom you sold to Egypt. Now therefore be not grieved, nor angry with yourself that you sold me hither. For God did send me before you to preserve life. For these 2 years has a famine been in the land, and yet there are 5 years in which there should be neither earing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve you a prosperity in the earth, and to save your lives by great deliverance. So now, it was not you that sent me hither, but God. And he has made me a father to Pharaoh, and lord of all his house, and a ruler for all the land of Egypt. If you can understand now that God has his hand upon you. All of us here have gone through heartaches. There might be more heartaches coming down the road. But you see, God is grooming you and me. He's grooming us for his eternity. You see, when we get over into the next life, we are not going to be male or female. We're not going to reproduce in heaven. We're going to be like the angels. And God has simply decreed that he wants to have X number of human beings that were saved, walked with him on this earth, matured, and he can go and harvest you and me so that he can use us in eternity to build a new creation. In the first creation, the angels were used to govern everything. They are here now to govern everything. In the next creation, the Bible says we are going to be above the angels, joint heirs with Jesus Christ, rulers with the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you understand that your life on this earth is a school? It's a time of preparation. But you are going to live forever and have a position in heaven for 1 million years, 10 billion years, zillions of years, and it goes and goes and goes. And when you have been in heaven for 1 billion years, and we might be hooking up someplace in that creation and sit down and have something nice to eat someplace, whatever they eat up there, we'll be eating. And I would say, "Hey, man, how you doing?" "Doing great. You remember Earth? A little tough down there?" Yeah, man, that was such a short time. We've only died for 120 years. 2 hours. We've only on Earth for 2 hours. And now, I've been ruling this galaxy for 1 billion years. And, you know, I'm going to keep ruling it. It's getting better and better. If you can get the mindset what God is doing, then your attitude will change. Circumstances are stepping stones. Matthew 13:24, and I got to rush here now. Matthew 13:24. If you can grasp this, I tell you what, nothing will phrase you here. All we got is a maximum 2 hours here on this earth. Matthew 13:24. We read this. Another parable Jesus put forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while man slept, his enemies came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when a blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared tares also. So the servant of the household came and said to him, Sir, did you not sow good seed in your field? From whence then has it tares? He said unto them, an enemy has done this. The servant unto him, will you then that we go and gather them up? But he said, nay, lest while you gather up the tares, you root also the wheat with them. Let them both grow together unto the harvest, and in time of harvest I will say to the reaper, gather together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. Hallelujah. The pill that you have to work with in the office, the bad boss you got, the nasty people you got to run with and stand every day, you know, they are tares. Some of them can be saved, and maybe we'll be saved. And God is simply saying this, I'm not going to uproot them because I might damage you. I'm going to let you be sanded against them a little bit because I want some character in you. And he simply is having a harvest time. I turn to Romans 9:10. It's Romans 9:10. And I really cannot do justice to Romans 9:10 here today, but I'll try to do it a little bit. In Romans 9, verse number 10, we read this. Matter of fact, I want to go up to verse number 16. So then it is not of him that wills, nor of him that runs, but of God that shows mercy. For the scripture says unto Pharaoh, even for the same purpose have I raised you up, that I might show my power in you, that my name might be declared throughout all the earth. Therefore hath he mercy on whom he will have mercy, and whom he will he hardens. Would you then say unto me, why does he yet find fault for who has resisted his will? Nay, but, O man, who are you that replies against God? Shall a thing formed say to him that formed it, why have you made me thus? Hast not a potter power over the clay, and the same lump to make one vessel to honor, and another dishonor? What is God willing to show his wrath, and to make his power known, endures with much long suffering the vessel of wrath fitted for destruction, and that he might know, and that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had afore prepared unto glory. You are here today. We don't have one vessel of destruction in this room. If you have accepted Christ, and I believe everyone in this room has accepted Christ, you are a vessel of honor. If you are watching us, and you might say, well, I have a desire in my heart to become saved, you're a vessel of honor. And God has simply prepared on this earth. He is grooming, working, preparing. He want a crop of graduates that will be running the next creation with him. Find a scripture, Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. Whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Now, I'm struggling temporarily with a problem with my nervous system. I know I will overcome that. I know that God will overcome that. But I also know this, I'm smart enough to know this, that if you break your leg or you break an arm or whatever it is, you don't go skiing until it's been healed. So I know this, that I need to kind of kick back and simply nurse myself and let the Holy Ghost heal me before I keep skiing again. But I do know this, I'm going to come out on top. If you understand now the story of Joseph, it's a story of you being called for eternal purposes. You are called for eternity. And God is simply saying this, I can give you a maximum learning period of 2 hours on the earth. That's the maximum you can get. You can stay in class for 2 hours max. Some people stay an hour, some less than an hour, some a little bit more than an hour. Some kick out, you know, before they're 50, some kick out but after 70, 80, whatever. But here's the good news. If you go home today and simply have a little prayer time and says, God, forgive me for complaining. Forgive me for looking at circumstances. My Heavenly Father, let me take care of each challenge and solve it through the Holy Ghost, so that I can learn a lesson and grow. Because if I'm going to run a galaxy, or you're going to run whatever they have up there, you know, you should be able to solve some small earthly problems. Like, what do you do with a car that breaks down? What do you do when the microwave oven stops functioning? What do you do when the toilet flows over? Do you have a fit, screaming and raging and saying, oh, God, why me? And he's looking down and saying, hey, kid, get it together. Learn. Let's stand. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank and praise you right now that I was able to deliver this message today, Lord. And I pray, Father, for people here in this congregation. I pray for people watching me, Father God, that they would grasp the beautiful news that Jesus saves. God is calling men and women, boys and girls, into his kingdom to be trained and groomed on this earth, and then for service for eternity in heaven. Thank you, Lord. I praise you right now. And I thank you, Father God, that every knee shall be strengthened. And that, Father God, everything will be straightened out. And that we shall be able to praise you with everything we have. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're watching, and you're simply saying this, I like what you said. I'd like to be part of that. But you're not. you say, God, forgive my sins. I recognize I'm a sinner. I recognize this. I believe that Jesus Christ saved me. I believe he died on the cross and rose on the third day. And I ask you right now to save me. Save me, Jesus. And he will. You say, Jesus, come on in. Come into my heart. I'll be my Lord and Savior. And he will. Call us, write us. That's helpful. And if you're a Christian, rededicate your life. Recommit yourself. And say, Jesus, help me to grow up. In Jesus' name. The altars are open here at Resurrection. The elders are here. Deacons are here. If you want to be prayed for, anointed with oil, maybe God called you something. Maybe you just need strength. You come. The altars are open.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking his commandments. That's why he said we've all sinned and fallen short of his standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends his love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with his shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that he sent his own Son to pay a debt he did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send his Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through his Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers his love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, he will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, he will do for you. If you call out to him, he will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All he wants for you is to come to him. He will help anybody who calls out to him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, he will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and he has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You have been listening to Pastor John S. Torell of Resurrection Life of Jesus Church in Sacramento, California. This message was the 25th part in the series, The Epistle to the Hebrews, and was entitled Joseph's Struggle. Joseph came from a dysfunctional family that consisted of one father, four mothers, and hateful siblings that sold him into slavery. Yet Joseph never allowed himself to become depressed and defeated because of circumstances, since he continually looked to God as his source. As a result, his godly attitude in life changed the circumstances that surrounded him. God had two plans for Joseph. First, that in time he would become the prime minister of Egypt. And secondly, that he would bring his family to Egypt where they would be kept for 430 years to grow and develop into a nation. Despite all his success on earth, God's earthly plan for Joseph pales in comparison to the eternal position prepared for him in heaven. God is still busy saving and grooming men and women to become citizens of His kingdom, and the earth is His training field for the new creation. This message is available on cassette, CD, and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1380. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can learn more about Pastor Terrell's ministry, read insightful articles, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the toll-free number in the United States is 1-888-708-3232. That's 888-708-3232. For calls from outside the U.S., the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.